God's absolute sovereignty, you believe that there are some things that are worth dying for. Now, let me just hit one more point. You see, if you believe in God's absolute sovereignty, then you believe that God brings to pass everything for our good, for His glory, and for opportunities of service. You see, Paul and Silas were thrown in prison in Acts chapter 16. And they didn't get in prison and start murmuring and complaining and said, "Oh God, we were just trying to serve you. Why were we thrown in here?" No. The Bible says, at midnight they sang and prayed unto God. And of course, God sent an earthquake and shook the prison and certainly got them out. But what were they doing? They were saying, "God has us here for a time and for a purpose." And even in prison, they were praising and glorifying God. You know, in the book of Philippians chapter 1, the Apostle Paul once again is thrown in prison. And the interesting thing is, he writes this, "But I would have you to know, brethren, that the things which are happened to me," he says, "have fallen out rather to the furtherance of the gospel, so that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace." Now, do you know what happened when the Apostle Paul was imprisoned in Rome? Well, they chained a Roman guard to him. Finally, the Roman guard looks at Paul and says, "What are you doing here?" Paul answers, "Well, I'm here because of the gospel of Jesus Christ." "Well," he said, "what is the gospel of Jesus Christ?" And for 3 hours, Paul preaches to him and teaches him about Jesus Christ. When his tour of guarding is up, here comes another guard, and he's shackled to Paul. And finally, that guard says, "Well, why are you here?" And Paul says, "I'll tell you." And the next thing you know, here is a whole household of believers in Caesar's own palace. So Paul said, "The thing which happened to me," that is his imprisonment, "was for the furtherance of the gospel." You see, if you believe in God's sovereignty, you don't believe in luck and chance and fate and fortune. You believe that God has brought everything to pass for His glory, for your good, and for opportunities of service. One of the most frequently asked questions is that if God is absolutely sovereign and God has all power, why is there so much sin and wickedness in the world? Well, the Bible certainly has the answer to that as well. Now, let me begin by quoting 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 3. There the Bible says, "For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication." Now, stop just a moment and think about that statement. This is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication. So it is God's will then that individuals abstain from fornication, that is, violations of the seventh commandment and all uncleanness and lasciviousness. Now, it's very obvious that there are a lot of people that are going contrary to that will. They're violating that will. They're committing fornication, they're committing adultery, they're committing all kinds of wickedness. So you have this verse then, "This is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you abstain from fornication." But then you come to Romans chapter 9 and verse 19. And Paul asks this question, "For who hath resisted his will at any time?" Indicating now that there is actually no one that can resist the will of God, because God is omnipotent. God is all-powerful. So, in Romans 9 and verse 19, Paul indicates that no one can resist his will. And yet, 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 3, very obviously, a great many people violate his will. Now, what is the answer? Are these two verses contradictory of each other? And the answer is, of course not. You see, when you go back to Deuteronomy 29 and verse 29, the Bible says, "The secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but the things which He hath revealed belong unto us and to our children, that we may do them forever." You see, the Bible is the revealed will of God. And the secret counsel of God is God's hidden will. Now, what you have in 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 3 is the revealed will of God. What you have in Romans 9 and verse 19 is the secret counsel of God. Now, no one can ever resist the secret counsel of God. Many resist the revealed will of God and violate it, but no one can ever go contrary to the revealed will of God. Now, that's why he says, the secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but the things which he hath revealed belong unto us and our children, that we may do them. So the revealed will of God, then, is the Word of God. The secretive will of God, of course, is his own hidden counsel. Now, the will of God, the revealed will of God, that is his Word, is frequently crossed. But the secret counsel, the hidden will of God, is never violated and it is never crossed. If you ever understand this principle, then you will understand that the saints of God need not be discouraged. Why? Because there's only going to be just enough wickedness that will ultimately redound for God's honor and God's glory and for our good. Now, let me try to lay this out for you. You see, God is not the author of evil. God is not the instigator of evil. God is not the infuser of evil. But that does not mean that God is not the controller of evil. God controls everything because he is absolutely sovereign. Now, in the book of James, chapter 1 and verse 13, the Bible says, "Let no man say when he is tempted, that I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. And sin, and when lust hath, when it hath finished, bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death." So God then is not the author of sin, he's not the instigator of sin, he's not the infuser of sin, but he is indeed the controller of sin. Now, let me try to explain and lay it out so we can all understand it. For instance, if I were to ask you this question, is harlotry, is prostitution contrary to the revealed will of God? And the answer is very obviously yes. The Bible said that no daughter of the children of Israel shall be a harlot or shall be a prostitute. The seventh commandment is, thou shalt not commit adultery. Now, since harlotry is very obviously contrary to the revealed will of God, here's my next question. Could God ever use a harlot to work out his own secret will and his own hidden counsel? And the answer to that is yes. All you have to do is go back and read Joshua chapter 2. Do you remember Rahab the harlot? Rahab took the two spies and hid them on the rooftop of her house. She covered them with flax, and when the king sent his men there, she came back and said, "Well, two men came into me, but I don't know where they went. Men come and go all the time in my house, but go down and chase after them. Surely you'll be able to overcome them." Now, have you ever stopped to think about this? If Rahab had been a decent, moral, godly woman, she would have never taken two strange men into her house. But you see, since she was a harlot, she took those two spies into her house and she hid them, and God used that harlot not only to save his spies, but to save the force that was going to come in and conquer Jericho. Now, listen to me carefully. God not only saved Rahab, he not only saved her house, but he also placed her in the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Now, God did not make Rahab a harlot. God did not infuse that wickedness in her, but God did indeed control that wickedness and use it to work out his own secretive will. But look in Acts chapter 2, beginning there with verse 23. Now, listen carefully, because here's what the Word of God says. The Bible is speaking, him, that is Jesus Christ, being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, you have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain. Now, Jesus Christ, the Bible says, is the Lamb slain from before the foundation of the world. And yet the Bible makes it very clear that Jesus Christ was crucified by the determinate counsel and the foreknowledge of God. Let me put it bluntly. Not one thing happened to Jesus Christ that was not ordained by God. Every detail, the minutest detail, had had been foreordained and determined.